Good evening, everyone. I'm pleased to welcome you all on behalf of Subversive Festival and Hannibal Foundation, which is co-organizer of this session. To most of you who have been attending Subversive Festival in the last week, you know this is a closing conference, closing session, and after a very intense week of many discussions on covering a variety of very relevant topics, we, as organizer committee, decided to close the conference with the very important message of future of democracy in Europe, particularly relating to tensions that exist today across Europe, at least originating from two points. One is, of course, increasing right-wing populism that is threatening the very basic constitutional values of the EU. And on the other hand, so-called economic constitutionalism that is actually aiming to, through arrangements like TTIP and similar intentions, to reduce the scope of democratic power of citizens and reduce overall ability of people to be engaged in decision making and shaping the future life. Today we have three speakers with us. Unfortunately, I have to apologize, Daniela Dolenec, a political scientist from Zagreb, who was not able to join us due to private issues. And I would like to share with you a joy that we can actually together today have a panel with speakers from Italy, from Germany, and from Spain or France. And I would like to introduce them briefly. Ugo Mattei will be our keynote speaker. Ugo Mattei, to maybe to those of you who are not aware of it, is one of the main protagonists of the successful referendum against privatization of water in Italy, also a lawyer and a political activist. Then Ska Keller, who is a European parliamentarian from the Green Group, originating from Germany. And Florent Marcellesi, who is a European spokesperson of Spanish Green Party, EQUO. Today we will have a debate after the keynote of Ugo Mattei that will refer to transformative power of the commons and role of the commons in the democratization of future life in Europe. We will have a debate among three of them, and in order to spare time, I would like to invite Ugo Mattei to deliver his keynote speech.
Thanks a lot for this invitation. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here to address the Subversive Festival. The topic I was given has to do with, I thought it was called the future of democracy and the transformative role of the commons. And I will start with a remark, which is, will in the future be possible to have some democracy in Europe? Should be the first question, because right now it is really kind of extremely feeble, the degree and the possibility to talk about democracy in Europe, both at the level of European institutions, and I look forward to discuss with Sky and with the members of the European Parliament about that, and also from the point of view of the political and legal systems of the member states of Europe. My claim is that in this last 25, 30 years or so, democracy got under a terminal crisis. Representative democracy got under a terminal crisis due to a change in the relationship of power between the private corporate sector and the public sector. The relationship of power today is such that representatives of the people in parliaments tend to be marginalized in favor of elites that get to government, to executive bodies, and the executive bodies in most of the Western liberal democracies, I would say in all of the so-called Western liberal democracies, are so much conditioned by corporate money that they end up not representing the people anymore, but represented actually corporate interests. This has been so for a very long time in the United States, a legal and political system that I know pretty well. It was already denounced back in the 50s by, in the very famous farewell address by President Eisenhower, who was not certainly a radical, that actually denounced the military complex, the military corporate complex, as a threat for the future of democracy at the time. Today, it seems to me that the relationship of power between the private and the public is unbalanced in favor of private in a very dramatic way. And the consequences are that the current model of liberal constitutionalism, or bourgeois constitutionalism, if we prefer to use a word that refers more to its origins, is not capable to deliver anything in the public interest, and it's really kind of becoming the problem rather than the solution. And when the political system, a political system, becomes the problem rather than the solution, it comes the time in which that political system should be subverted. And we are at a subversive festival, so I guess that I'm not saying anything especially revolutionary, given the context. But I would like to make you think about the origins of political theory in the West, and the so-called right of resistance, that was a very important in the Ancien Régime, that was theorized by the Huguenots lawyers back in the 17th century, and was actually always considered a collective right, actually a collective duties to lower magistrates to resist the political order in the moment in which the political order acts in a way that is not in the interest of the political body, but against its interest. So it seems to me that we are now at a point in which if we continue the way we are now walking, it is very clear that there is not going to be any future for civilization, not only in Europe, but in the world. Today, the footprints of humankind is 1.4, roughly. That means that we are consuming 40% more resources that are reproduced by the Earth. And it's 1.4 only because a large number of people in the world live well below the average consumption. Because if everybody in the world was living like my friends and fellow Americans in the North, we would need 5 planets. Footprint is 5. If we all would live like the Western Europeans, it would be like almost 4. So we still need 4 planets. This means something very simple, that the promise of growth, the promise of development, that is actually within the dominant political discourse, both of the right and on the left, is simply a cynical lie. We cannot promise and deliver a future for everybody on the planet to live the way we do live. And because we cannot promise that, but we do it anyway, in the moment in which we do that, we are actually doing something extremely bad. That is, we are kind of advertising something that will bring to the destruction of the planet in a very short time. And we are, in fact, putting on actions that are completely coherent with the necessity to keep only for us the amount of resources that we want to use. In other words, Europe and the United States and the West are putting together policies and political structures that are based on the fundamental need to exclude, not to share, and to be the only one that consume in a very short-sighted banquet all the resources of the world. The state of the affair calls for resistance. And in order to make resistance effective, we do need to actually understand the roots of the problem, and we need to have viable solutions for solving it. If we don't understand the roots of the problem, we cannot see the solutions. And if we do not have solutions that are in some way feasible, we will fall into utopian thinking, and we will never be able to overcome the current state of affairs. Very, very briefly, because I haven't been given a long time, let me go to the roots of the problem. And the roots of the problem are actually at the very origins of modernity. Modernity as a project worked as a conscious attempt to transform commons into capital. There was a need to solve some fundamental human needs. The need to feed yourself, the need to clothing, the need of shelter. All those needs that before were delivered by the commons in pre-modern societies, delivered by the forest, delivered by the village system, delivered by the free access to water, to firewood, to birds, to animals, to fishes, all of that, that allowed for a subsistence economy, became incapable to work in order to develop conditions of the new world. And that was the great original transformation that started with the need to take some of these commons and to transform them into capital. The way this was done was through enclosures, we know very well, was to creating private property as an institution. It was through plunder of the new world, to discover faraway lands and to capture them in private property, and to develop institutions of statehood that would change the precedent political system by concentrating the power in the hands of the government. So the institutions of modernity, the fundamental political institutions of modernity, were private property and state sovereignty, as epitomized by the famous figures of John Locke and Thomas Hobbes. Of course, there is many other people that theorized that, but these are the guys who became really famous as the respective theorists of statehood and property. Interestingly, these two notions that are actually share completely their legal origins, they all come from the dominium idea of the Roman law. They all come from the need of centralizing power in a given territory by excluding the other. So the two fundamental structures of both private property and state sovereignty are concentration of power and exclusion. Get out of my house, I'm the owner. Stay out of my kingdom, I'm the king. Okay, so concentration of power and exclusion are at the roots of both these categories that in the dominant rhetoric of the Western discourse that was developing as a scientific project started to be described as opposite to each other. Property and state sovereignty were seen as conflicting entities, and modern constitutionalism was born out of the fundamental idea that the individual owner should be protected against the sovereign power of Leviathan. So the big Leviathan power, the concentrated power of sovereignty, needed to be limited in favor of the private owner in order to avoid abuses of the powerful against the powerless. This fundamental compromise was set and sealed in England in the so-called Glorious Revolution in 1688, but that was actually the first very fundamental deal of the relation between private property and statehood, as then ended up becoming the characterizing aspect of the modern institutional setting. The purpose of that was the transformation of commons into capital. Commons were institutions of diffused power and were institutions of inclusion. Commons were not based on the individual, were based on the group, on small groups, and both the private property and the state resisted and resented the commons as institutions. The need was to concentrate the power, to transform the value, the use value of resources into exchange value, in order to accumulate wealth and invest for the purpose of development. We needed to concentrate capital to have industry, manufacturing, hospitals, education, all the kind of things you need some capital to do, and that were impossible to do in the conditions of use values of pre-modern societies. We did a great job in doing that. As political theorists, as politicians, and as lawyers, we created all sorts of social sciences and social disciplines to develop institutional setting that could extract value from the commons and transfer it into the capital. From the legal point of view, not only state, sovereign statehood and private property, but also the fundamental idea of limited liability corporation in the theories of Hugo Grotius, for example, was born at the time. The general theory of fault liability, protecting the risk taker against the consequence of his risk. If you have no fault, if you don't have any fault, then the consequences of your risk remain where they fall. Institutions such as freedom of contract, for example, are other aspects of this sort of gigantic intellectual building that was modern law that created a backbone for the development of capital. We were successful in that. Lawyers participated with scientists in describing the reality in those terms. Francis Bacon, for giving you an example, was both a famous scientist. We owe to Francis Bacon the birth of scientific positivism, the fundamental idea that the truth should be tortured out of nature through experiments. In other words, that science could allow us to actually dominate nature. And also, he was a very famous lawyer. He was the Lord Chancellor of England. He was one of the fundamental architects of the compromise that then ended up into the Glorious Revolution. René Descartes, the great philosopher, was also contributing very much to this idea. The reality was seen as a machine. There was a distinction between an objective world and out there and a subjective element, the element of the individual. This fundamental opposition disempowered the individual from the external world in the sense that considered the reality something that existed already, could only be transformed through processes, but actually that reality, as we know now, doesn't really exist if not interpreted by the subject. So the structure of modernity has been a project, and this project was successful so that today we don't have commons anymore, but we have a lot of capital. If you think about it, at the time in which the modernity started, you know, there was plenty of water, plenty of forests, plenty of resources, plenty of collective institutions, such as guilds, corporations, villages, extended families, connections of a variety of way, all commons institutions, institutions that would put the long run at the center, and there would be very little capital. The Venetians, for example, built their homes in the lagoon by using wood coming from a commons institution in nearby Trentino that was called the Premiata Comunità di Fiemme that used to actually maintain for three generations the wood to season before selling it to Venice, and the wood is still there in the water after all these centuries. Similar techniques were used in the Alps, in the mountain Alps to build, were used in India for water organizations, were used all over the world as institutions of decentralization rather than institutions of concentration of power. Today, those institutions are gone. The Brits colonized England and destroyed the water system in India, substituting it with a centralized system of big works like dams and stuff like that. The modern project of the law, with the Napoleonic Code and so on and so forth, outlawed completely every institution that would be in between the individual property owner and the state. everything in between was simply considered illegal and maintained outside of the legal orbit. Today we have a huge capital. We have about 10 times more the value of our financial capital, as it was accounted after the big crisis in 2008, was roughly 10 times the gross domestic product of the whole world. But we don't have commons anymore. And still we do have the same institutions. We still have institutions that have as a main purpose the transformation of commons into capital. The very same institution that worked so successfully to bring us here, that are at the core of the political and legal organization of the West, simply do their job. And their job is to keep going in the same direction that we now know is complete and sustainable. Therefore, we need a radical change in our institutional setting, and we need that radical change, not so much by external interventions that here and there transform things, but in a very revolutionary vision of the law that rejects entirely the structure of the professionalized legal system of the West, the very dichotomy of the idea what is legal and what is illegal, the very idea that the law is something out there, separated from us, that are the users of the legal system, the very idea that the law is something that respects and is determined by human decisions that have nothing to do with ecological processes. We need to organize legal and political institutions that once again put the human laws in some sense in coherence with the laws of nature. We need, in other words, legal institutions that mirror the way in which natural processes reproduce themselves and try to make us once again not outside of nature as we like to look at ourselves, but within nature with the same constraints and the same limits that every other creature in the world has. How to do that? Well, you see, one thing that we learned from ecology is that nature is not a machine, is not made by an aggregate of discrete component parts that can be measured in quantitative terms, is not an engineering building, is something different. Science today tells us that the whole is much different from the aggregate of its parts. The old Cartesian Baconian vision of society that could be, and of nature, that could be decomposed in small pieces that then can be studied in mechanistic laws, proved to be false. The Newtonian exercise, the laws of Newton, Newton was the last one who actually talked about laws of nature. His laws of physics are actually still valid, but in very narrow domains. We can still use them, but we know that the scientific processes cannot be described just in the mechanistic way they were described before. Yet, the legal system is still described as an aggregate of individuals separated from each other in direct relationship with something called the legal system that is a framework out there that determines their behavior and that is not determined by them. This is really false. In fact, as much as the natural processes are relationships, are ecological communities that act in that connect with each other, that are open to large networks that make the natural system resilient and very adaptable to the same circumstances, the law needs to be organized around collective institutions such as the commons. This is where the commons become a fundamental notion. It becomes a legal notion capable to put together the forces of the people in a cooperative effort that involves everybody, not only of our species, but also of other species, not only of our generation, but also future generations. The law needs to function once more, putting at the center communities. And it needs to do so sooner rather than later by refusing flatly so much of the rhetoric of modernity that has produced much of our technocratic specialized knowledge. what does this mean in practice? In practice, it means that the legal system has now to challenge the institutions of representation of the state, has to challenge the idea that complex system can be governed and monitored from the top down, has to realize that the collective intelligence of a group of people is necessarily more capable of solutions that are adaptable and capable to live in the long run than any decision of one person alone. It has, in other words, to move away from all the keywords that neoliberalism has now introduced to present our life experience as a competition of an individual against another individual for the purpose of controlling and submitting as much portion as possible of nature, as if it was possible to do so forever in an infinite way. After all, if you invite for dinner someone and you have a limited amount of food, and this guy goes to the table first and eats as much as possible as he can in a very efficient way, assuming a lot of calories in a very little amount of time, and you know that the food is limited, all the other people will consider that guy a very undesirable company. He will be considered a brutal human being, incapable of responsibilities and connections for the others that are not there yet, that still have to come, or that he should respect. Yet, if you think about it for a moment, today, the rhetoric of corporate capitalism celebrates behaviors of this kind by the 1% of the population of the world as something that needs to be admired. The rhetoric of neoliberalism and the dominant discourse celebrates the rich, the powerful, the tycoon, those that go around skiing on helicopters, those that drive very expensive cars, those that consume much more resources than of their fair share, as if they were doing so out of their own right. It is my right. I'm paying for it. These are the classic things that someone that is leaving his gas-gulping SUV switched on while waiting for his kids in front of the high school in an expensive area of the United States will answer to anyone else who say, would you please switch off the engine? They say, I'm paying for the gas, therefore the gas is mine, therefore I can do whatever I want. This is a typical example of the mentality that individualism and private property has introduced in all of us by making us confusing the notion of the is with the notion of the have. Freedom is freedom of being, not freedom of having. We have to consider and construct institutions that are capable to build communities within which each one of us is free of being, but is not free of having, taking away from the others. This is gonna be an economy of sharing. This is gonna be an economy of responsibility. This is gonna be an economy based on an idea of life and an idea of living together that certainly will limit us in some of our consumption habits, but that we cannot postpone much longer. It is a very challenging task that goes through thinking again at the basis of our fundamental organization, from the legal, political, economic, and scientific perspective. It is a long way to go, but the conditions will not be planned at the table. They will be probably happen sooner than we expect, and we'd better be ready, thinking differently and with some fantasy to how to put together a new, better world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ugo. The framework of your thought will be certainly something we will come back for discussion later. Now I would like to invite Ska to give a short contribution on how do you see actually what are the constraints for future democratic developments in Europe particularly from green perspective.
Yeah, thanks. Vedran, you mentioned earlier that you think that the democratic system is broken in Europe, and well, I would a bit challenge that, and not just because my job depends on that, but also because I really think that even though it's hugely challenged and it's not at all perfect, I would not think that democratic system such is broken. Reason number one is that we're actually talking about that. I mean, imagine a couple of years ago, who would have been talking about democracy in Europe? You would have been talking about democracy in a nation state, in I don't know what sort of institution. You wouldn't have been talking so much about democracy in Europe. And I think there has been a huge development about people demanding more democracy in Europe, and a lot of steps also being taken if we look at all the citizens' initiatives that have been happening at the European level. If we look now at the TTIP campaign, then we actually see that people are mobilizing and organizing across borders and creating a European democracy, because indeed you cannot, you know, do democracy simply by putting institutions or laws in place. That certainly helps and it has to be part of it. But part of democracy is also that you have, for example, a European-wide debate, which has not been taking place for a long time, and we see it more and more happening, and I think TTIP is a key example of how that happens, about how a discourse is happening all over Europe with similar arguments. So I think that's very positive. Well, TTIP not, but the whole debate around it. And secondly, why I think it's not completely broken is that actually the people who get elected to the European Parliament, they do exactly what they've been saying in the election campaign. You have conservatives that get elected on a neoliberal agenda, on fighting against, for example, migrants and fighting against minorities. They get elected for that. And that's exactly what they're doing then later on. So in that sense, it works pretty well. I mean, not from my perspective, obviously, because I'm fighting for something else. But I have to also see that apparently there is a majority in Europe that actually wants to have this conservative and neoliberal agenda. And in that sense, if we would have a different majority, things might look very different. And of course, I'm fighting for that different majority. But I have to acknowledge that in the end, you know, it's not that there was an election campaign and the conservatives have been promising to whatever, let in all the migrants and create equal marriage rights and I don't know what. And then in the end they say, sorry, we won't. No, they actually do exactly what they've been elected for. They do exactly what they've been promising. So in that sense, there is stuff that actually works pretty well. But there is a lot of challenges, absolutely. They are both institutional in the sense that we as the European Parliament, we're the only directly elected body of the European Union, and you find a lot of the usual democratic fights between different groups who have different ideas, and exactly that's what they've been elected for. And it's very difficult to transport that to the general public, to media, to people, because in the end, when I'm sitting around in debates, you know, people always consider me basically to be the spokesperson of the European Union as such, or the Commission, and it's always more about explain this or explain that rather than explain or defend a position vis-a-vis somebody else's position. So there is a challenge. We have the challenge of the member states that are also still being around that play a huge role in that, unfortunately still bigger than the European Parliament. So how do national governments come into play here? For example, on TTIP, or on migration, the European Parliament gets challenged a lot. But if you look at how the power struggle is going, you would actually see that lots of member states are playing a more vital role there, but they do so behind closed doors. So I think that is one of the institutional challenges that we need to address. But there's also a lot of non-institutional challenges. I mentioned already movement centering, for example, around trade agreements. And that is really good that it's happening now, that we have a coalition of more than 250 NGOs from all over Europe doing things. But on a lot of areas, we're still missing a lot of social mobilization. For example, trade unions are still functioning very much according to a national logic. They are well, we have the European Trade Union Confederation, sure, and they're doing a great job. But we also know that when we look at the national labor unions, they're the stronghold. And then they, of course, will say, oh, yes, the European level is very important. And they will maybe sometimes go to a demonstration or to a meeting, but it's not the center of their focus. It's not what they really do. It's not what they really focus on. And I think that really needs to change. Also, on a lot of struggles that we've seen all over Europe, and Florent's going to talk more about that, there is intentions to coordinate a bit across Europe, but it's still more a matter of, you know, looking at the other guys and saying, oh, cool, what they've been doing, but not a matter of really doing a Europe-wide struggle. And I think that is really missing, and that would give more of a democratic drive also to the European level, because in the end, democracy is also what we all make out of it. And that, I think, is still very, very much challenged. And also that we see Europe as the separate bloc, and we're forgetting that we're now in Zagreb and that Croatia is part of the European Union, so that it's all one construction altogether, and that we don't have to go to Brussels to be in Europe, and that decisions taken in Brussels, as it's always called, are also taken in Zagreb or in Madrid or I don't know where. So that, I think, certainly still is a very, very, very big challenge. And indeed, then we have those guys who actually understood much better than many, let's say, more on our side, how Europe works, or how to influence decision making in Europe. That is indeed the corporations, the big industries. They have understood very well how to use the European level and the member states. They have very well understood to create a network around and to really go to the places where the decisions are being made. And in lack of a counterpower, in lack of a counterbalance, they are very influential and they're very successful on that. If we just look at, for example, the financial sector, how much big financial industry, how banks are influential. And on the other hand, it had to be coming out of the European Parliament to create something like Finance Watch to have a kind of counterbalance, counterforce, simply on the scientific, on the argumentation point of view. And that, I think, is very problematic. Sure, that's often similar in the national capitals, but probably even more so at the European Union level. And we see that in things, well, again, to TTIP, because it's such a perfect example. Of course, the reason why it's being negotiated, why we're having all this neoliberal trade agenda, is because there's certain interest in that, because big companies will profit from that, and they want it to happen, and that's why everybody's pushing for it, not just for that. There's also a lot of personal sensibilities around there. The last trade commissioner wanted to have his personal crown with TTIP. There's a lot of geopolitical blah blah around it that is not very nice. But in the end, there is a lot of interest behind that. But TTIP also shows us how it can go in the other direction, how we can have a European movement, how the voice of the people is actually being heard. They're super nervous in the Commission. They're super nervous in the member state governments, at least in those that really want TTIP. They're very, very nervous for the simple reason that people are going on the streets. And now we hear from the Commission, yeah, it's just in Germany and Luxembourg and Austria where we have a big opposition. But it's just that on those three countries, we actually have a majority of the population that is completely against that. I mean, imagine that a majority of the population is against a trade agreement. In the other countries, you also have a sizable minority being against, so something we're more used to. So there's always sizable opposition, but it's just that in only three countries, we have a majority of population being against that. So it's a crazy scale. I mean, imagine a couple of years ago, somebody would have mentioned a trade agreement, I don't know, FTA with India, for example, or Singapore or South Korea, you know, everybody would have been sleeping by now, but now it's a big issue. And I think this has really been a great success. And this success has also been carried forward by the European Parliament together with civil society, well, let's say from the left wing of the European Parliament. And we have managed to stop a trade agreement already. A couple of years ago, the anti-piracy, like product piracy agreement, ACTA, was stopped. In the end, there was a majority because, you know, there was a sizable movement on the streets and in the internet of Europe, and that has made a huge impression. So it's not like, you know, it's completely uncontrollable what's happening in parliaments, or that parliaments don't have power, but we need to pressurize at the right moments, and we need to push people in the right moments, address the right people, and we need to mobilize and connect across Europe and get out of this, you know, we're doing our small thing here in this country and maybe still looking at what exotic things, you know, the movement is doing in Spain or in France or I don't know what. It really needs to be a connected European movement. Then we can actually achieve something. It does not mean that there's not a lot of institutional challenges and I don't know what sort of democratic challenges, but I think there's also, when there's a challenge, there's also great opportunity. And I see how this is more and more influencing and, let's say, frightening the people who are taking the decisions in terms of member state government, in terms of European Commission. So I would be looking a bit more with optimism into that future.
Yeah, I'll pass you. We can share. Okay. Thank you, Scott. Right, exactly here we can continue with Florence's contribution, particularly focusing on the relationships between the movements. You're coming from the Spain where there are elections during this month. You probably can really depart from the point where you can explore these relationships between movements and the representative politics. As one of the challenges for the future of democracy.
Good evening, buenas tardes. Well, the fact I wanted to bring to the floor the study case, because we spoke about history, we spoke about European level, and I think we have to go back to the ground and speak about Spain, because that's a good study case between with the relationship between grassroots movement or movement, social movements in politics, because that's a good date to tell about that, to speak about that, because today that's the 16th of May, and yesterday that was the 15th of May. And 4 years ago, we had the Los Indignados movement, because 4 years ago, we went to the places of Spain, the main places, and we are sitting there, just reclaiming more democracy, real democracy, democracia real día. And we have thousands of people reclaiming that. But then we have to ask ourselves, what was the relations and what are the impacts in politics right now of this kind of movement that we had 4 years ago? Because we have a first point. This social movement was not a social movement from leftist party, for example. That was not a minority social movement. That was a social movement that had the approval of more than 80% of people in Spain. 80% of people in Spain just supported the Indignados movement that we had. But then, what happened? 3 years, that's a lot for a social movement. 3 years, that's a lot to be able to have some assemblies, some local assemblies, some autogestion assembly. That was not so possible. Then it had been weakened. And then appeared last year, something that you know very well, because I think that they were in the Subversive Festival last week, Podemos. And Podemos, that's the intent to translate, to convert this cultural hegemony that we had with the Indignados movement to politics. And there's this bad point where we have a lot of debate in the progressive movement, because we're going to see that we have a lot of questions raised by the tactic and the strategy followed by Podemos. Because Podemos said the following things. If we want to convert this cultural hegemony that we won in the places with people, we have to use a populist strategy. A populist strategy, because they say, they call themselves populist, so that's not a bad word in that case, because they are using the Ernest Laclau, philosopher, Argentinian, he died last year. Yes, he was 90 years old, something like that. And he had a very famous book, The Populist Reason, where he explained what you have to do if you want to gain political hegemony. And that's three points, three important points. First of all, you have to use catch-all concept. That means concept that doesn't mean anything, but do mean everything at all. That means that everyone with different demands can understand and just can be identified in this catch-all concept. So Polemo said, that's all right. We saw that the indigenous movement was so transversal that we have to go at the left-right axis. And we're going to speak about the new against the old. We're going to speak about the people against the caste, the establishment, the elite. We're going to speak about democracy against dictatorship. And that was that what they did. And that was what they succeeded to do, because all people just understood from an emotional point of view that the caste were the bad people. And that was identifying the problem on, on a basic way to do that. Second point, you have to have a very strong leadership. Because the people, has to be identified in one person. And that was the case. Polemos did the same thing. They said, yeah, we have someone very famous, thanks to TV show, that's Pablo Iglesias in that case. So we have to use him to be the reflect of people. And so, for example, in European elections in 2014, last year, they just chosen to do something very strong for a leftist party or for people coming from the transformative movement or emancipation movement. They said, we're going to do something, well, we're going to break a rule, because on the ballot paper, they didn't put the logo of Podemos. They didn't put something very collective, as you said before, like the commons. No. They put the face of Pablo Iglesias, identifying people to the leader. And then the third point, very important, is that you have to win hegemony. The hegemony concept is very a key concept for the populism strategy. And then if you speak about hegemony, you speak something very contrary to diversity, because hegemony doesn't like diversity. You have to be the big one. You have to kick out the other one. Outside, you have to be the new social democracy in that case, or inside, because you don't like criticism. So, how do you put these three concepts working? Well, you have to make a vertical and hierarchical organization. That's what we've done. And that's the first debate that we have in Spain. So we say, all right, you want people to be horizontal. You want to sell something horizontal. You want to change the things from the grassroots movement. And when you come to politics, the first thing that you do is to make a vertical organization. That's the first contradiction and the first debate that we have. The second debate that we have, they say we have to build an electoral machine war. That's their words, that's not mine. So, yes. You want to change the world, and you want to make, like the other ones, to have a machine war to gain the institution. So that's a good debate to have. Do you want to make politics as the elite that you are criticizing? Or do you want to make politics, changing the world, making politics? For example, and that's a good example of what happened recently, you have the Spanish king that came to the European Parliament, and there was Pablo Iglesias, and he gave a gift to the Spanish king. Do you know what was the gift? You know, yeah, he was in the European Parliament. Do somebody know what was the gift he gave to the Spanish king? That was some DVD. And what was the DVD of a good, I don't know if that's so good, because that's a DVD of Game of Thrones. And he told the Spanish king, well, let's see, that's the story of Spain. And that's how I want to do politics. But how they do politics in Game of Thrones? They betrayed, they have some violence, a lot of sex too, but that's another case. But you have a lot of violence and betrayed. So I ask myself, is that the way we want to do some politics? Is that the way we want to gain the institution? Because if we're an institution power doing the same things than before the elite, I don't know if we have changed the world. And I think that's the main point that we have to reflect about that. And then I think that we have another point talking about social movements, because we had something very weird happen in 3 years. Because I remember three years ago, when the social Indianos movement began, all the people in the social movement said, we don't want to be in politics. We don't like politics. Politics sucks. They said 4 years ago. But right now, all these people saying that, they are in politics. Because with the new wave of Podemos, of they are trying to be in politics because they saw that was they couldn't do what they want to do before in the social movements. But that's a problem too, because if all the people, all the good people what we had before in social movements are right now in politics, we don't have any counter movement. We don't have any social movements strong enough to remember or to say the politics what they have to do. So we have this problem in Spain right now of social movements weakened by the politic. And then we have the last point that I wanted to raise about something that Hugo said before. That's a narrative. Which narrative we want to tell the people? Because, and that's the big issue that I got with my fellow friends of Podemos, because I come from the ecological politics, from the Greens, and I'm convinced, as you said before, that we are going right to the end, we are going right to the collapse, because we are consuming more, much over the threshold of the capacity of planet to absorb and to regenerate all the natural resources. But the narrative of my friends, of the left parties, is growth. But we have to grow once more. We have to consume more and more. You have to produce more and more for more jobs. More consuming, more producing, for what? In this narrative, that's not the good narrative, because growth today is not the solution. Growth is the main problem that we have. And we have to change the narrative and the contents of what we reclaim. And that's true that we have to speak about commons, as Hugo said, and we have to speak about interdependency. Not sovereignty, not like all the things that Hobbes said 400 years ago. No, we have to speak about interdependency, because people, we depend on other people and we depend on nature. And I think that this narrative has to be central in each emancipative social movements or political movements. That's the base, I think. I think that's in that case, we have a lot of debate coming from Spain, because this is the case. Just, I'm very negative on my part, because I don't think we have a good narrative. I don't think we have the good organization. That was a fresh air, that's true. But we don't have the possibility and the capacity to change the world with this kind of thing. So I think maybe you have to take once more the words of John Holloway, a Zapatist theoretical person that we have in Mexico, because I think that we can change the world without taking the power, and we have to change the world not only in this institutional power, we have to change the world on the grassroots, going back to what we know, not using power among people, but power to do something. And I think that's a big change that we have to do. Think more about cultural thing, think more about how we're acting, and less about taking power just to kick out the elites. That's a part, and that's a very important part. I am in European Parliament too, but I think that's just something secondary. First, we have to change how we think, how we act, how we eat, how we just believe in the daily day. That's the commons for me. That's democracy, and that's the lessons I've got from Spain. Gracias. Thank you.
Thank you. I would like to ask maybe Hugo, do you have any direct response or maybe an additional comment to the interventions?
Well, I do think that I'm still very much persuaded that political action is determined by the places and the institutions in which we operate. So if you sit in the board of directors of the World Bank, or if you sit in the board of the IMF, or if you sit in the board of a telecom or of a TV company, private or something, you can be the best person in the world as a human being, but as an institutional actor, you are someone that is gonna destroy the system. Because you operate within constraints that are such that you are obliged from your legal duties to your shareholders to behave as a jerk. Period. Okay. If you are this has nothing to do with being a good person or a bad person or an asshole or anything like that. It's just the fact that you are constrained if you operate in those settings. If you operate in a parliament, you operate within a represented political system, you are constrained by the needs of being elected and re-elected. And you are constrained and obsessed by the fact that you have to bring people to vote for you. And you're gonna put your face in the ballot. And you're gonna do all these kind of things, you know, to create a vertical structure or whatever. And then, you know, maybe you kick off the previous power and you're reproducing exactly the kind of control of power they made before. Because it's not that you are good and they are bad. You are both in the same institutional setting. And if you are a politician, you reason in 5 years re-election terms, period. All of this has been theorized and stratheorized by, you know, things called public choices, analysis in the United States, in economics, in political science. I mean, there are tons of literature. Tons of literature. And to the point that is even called rational choice theory, that means that if a politician is not obsessed by being re-elected, is not rational. Okay? So a politician that believes in something is depicted as a kind of crazy oddball because he's not acting as a rational human being. Okay? This means that institutions matter. So what I'm interested in doing here is to think about the way in which you can radically transform the institution by understanding that institutions are us. That the distinction between some sort that is established and something that is in the making is ideology. That most of the way in which we reason about politics is completely constrained by ideological structures that serve the imperatives of capital accumulation. That is the kind of analysis I'm interested in. For example, it's not like by chance that I say that today the corporations are stronger than the political powers of the states. The fact is that corporations can actually grow forever. They don't die. That's the difference between me, her, you, and the corporation. The corporation doesn't die, can grow forever, okay? And, you know, Goldman Sachs in 1929 was like 15 advisors to some wealthy clients. Today, they have about 500,000 employees in the world, and among these employees, there are most prime ministers and economic ministers of Western world. There is no one former minister that doesn't work for Goldman Sachs in France, in Italy, in Germany, in the United States. What are we talking about? Are we happy that the right is voted for doing the right and the left is voted for doing the left, and that is democracy? You know where the decisions are taken? Do you think any decision relevant is taken in the European Parliament? Tell me one decision that is important to the European Parliament. What is this? We have to be realistic on the kind of relationship of power in which we are operating. We're excited if we resist some rounds of the secret treatment, but the secret treatment is going on anyway. And these corporate people are deciding anyway. And the political institution, national or European, doesn't matter, don't simply matter anymore. This is because the growth, the perennial growth of those institutions made them much stronger than governments because they operate globally. They are not constrained even by the, you know, by the worry of pretending that they are democratic. Most of our life is determined by corporations, not by parliaments. You make a phone call, you're controlled by a telecom. You enter in any kind of action of your life, you deal with a huge political structure, which is a corporation that doesn't claim any structure of democracy whatsoever. There is a CIO, and there is a vertical chain. And that is where the decisions about our life are taken. So this, we should be very clear about this. So once we agree on the analysis, and so we kind of understand where the enemies are, because if we kind of live in the world of dreams, then I don't. We are really incapable of kind of giving any effective political action. Then we should target what we can actually do. And the only thing that does work, and you are perfectly right on that, is the physical body of the people in between the extraction of capital and the working of society. So the reason why for a while in 2011, you know, there were things that were almost changing is because there were some physical threat to the power. And the reaction, of course, has been very harsh. You know, in Spain now you cannot camp in the places anymore, and we're going to see what happens with Podemos. And I really, frankly, I would be very, very happy if Podemos wins the elections. But we had Beppe Grillo in Italy that got 25% of the vote on a platform that was like Podemos, like a crazy leader. I mean, I think that Pablo is not crazy, but I mean, the other guy is really crazy. Like a crazy leader that has all the power and the populist bullshit, you know, was all out there. He got 25%. What happened? They didn't give him the government. The result was that they kicked him out and he was incapable of doing any politics. He spends all the time talking about how pure his members of parliament are as opposed to the others that are crooks. Is that what we want? I mean, is that transforming something? The real transformative thing to do is to try to actually be subversive in the use of the institutions we have. Okay? So right now, the situation is such that the private property institutions, okay, the institutions of private property are much, much stronger than the public institutions. So if we occupy a place, we need to establish the place that is occupied as a private property. We need to privatize in a counter-hegemonic way. In other words, we have to create property structures in the interest of future generations, in the interest of the ecology, that are stronger than elected governments. That's what we have to do. This is the important step. We need trust in the interest of future generations. We need institutions like that, because today, otherwise, these governments will privatize everything for the private interest of the short term, not privatize things for the long-term interest, okay? They are gonna do that under economic pressures as is happening in Greece. We are here talking about democracy in Europe. Look at what's happening in Greece in these days. I mean, these guys are not allowed to decide what to do politically. These guys are kind of considered crazy oddballs because they are taking into consideration the fact that the legal idea of pacta sunt servanda might be sometimes, you know, something to be rediscussed. And we have this Shylock thing that say, no, you cannot move, you know, one inch like this, you have to do this, you have to do that. Where is the political sovereignty there? So the point is to me, I mean, at this point, is how to try to construct institutions that resist the power of the represented governments. These are the kind of institutions that are the people's institution. When we did the foundation of the Teatro Valle in Rome, for example, that was the idea, you know, creating an institution that is actually born from the bottom up, trying to create its own structure around it that allows it to function in the legal world, but it's a new, completely different legality. We need to reorganize the institutions really from the bottom up. And this means, you know, organization, not of like, a political party that is vertical, but real organization. It's not that there is either vertical organization or no organization, because that is what seems to be around. But if you look how the Communist Party was organized in Italy before 1944, when Togliatti came back from Moscow and decided that we had to run for office, okay, basically betraying the revolution, That was the fact. The Communist Party in Italy was organized in an incredibly efficient way throughout the country. Anywhere in the country, there would be cells that were organized. There was a huge effort in creating the best possible leadership, and there was an idea to reorganize the society outside of the bourgeois liberal constitutional order. That was the idea. How can we kind of reorganize our society outside of the bourgeois constitutional order that brought us here and that will bring us faster and faster to crash against the reality, which is that we cannot grow forever? There is a right of resistance when the ideology of the elite who is governing us and of the institutions that are governing us is bringing us to die. This is the point. So this kind of organizational effort is important to me. Not so much to win the elections, nor to remain in the movements in a kind of vague sphere, but to put together a plan that is genuinely internationalist, and I agree with her on this, that you cannot move anymore just at the local level. You need to be internationalist. I don't think it must be only European. I'm not for this concept that Europe, why are we so obsessed with Europe? Because we want to compete with America and with Asia. What's the point of Europe as such? The point is to have the people understanding together that there is one world, and it is in one world we should organize ourselves in order to keep it for the generation that have to come.
Yeah, thanks. Fits quite well then, I guess. I consider that it's important, for example, if the European Parliament decides next week whether in that phone there is going to be conflict minerals or not, if the European Parliament rejects TTIP or not, I think that's relevant. And the European Parliament also decides about who's going to get asylum, whether, for example, women who are persecuted because of their gender, whether they get asylum or not. I think that's fairly relevant. But nevertheless, absolutely, we need to talk about institution, how to radically reorganize them. You were yourself running, or like you organized this this initiative, the citizens initiative against water privatization. And there again, you had to try to find as many people as possible to sign up or to go to vote. So indeed, this question of how do you find a majority, or like at least a sizable amount, is really important. And exactly, and especially when we come to the growth question, where I absolutely agree, it's a huge, huge thing. I mean, we're at the verge of ecological collapse, and that's not a light thing to do. But how do we actually make sure that people are seeing that? And there I don't see, and I'm completely with Florent, that, you know, for example, in the left movement, that's not at all, you know, on people's screen, you know, because it's this growth thing, it's about so different sorts of growth, certainly, and inclusive growth, and I don't know what sort of growth, but it's still always about growth. And well, you were criticizing this thing about, you know, trying to find majorities, etc. But in the end, how do we get change to happen if it's just a very few people who are believing an idea? We have to get out and convince other people. That's the whole point. I mean, that's politics, yes, but that's also movement, that's also organization. We have to go out and convince people. That's why we have to also use, for example, language that people understand. We have to use examples that are relating to people's lives. But still, we have to go out. We cannot sit around and say, well, we're right, and we know we're right, and we're going to go down with the flags raised. No, we have to go out and try to change things. But for that, we need to have more people around than just in this room. We need to go out and convince people. For me, this is what politics is about. For me, that's what political struggle is about.
Thank you. Okay, I think now we can open floor for comments and questions or remarks. Are there any questions? So one, two, three, okay, four. So let's, okay. So let's go to the left side and take two questions there, and then we go. Okay, four questions more after this too. Yeah, I will collect maybe two questions now, and then let's see.
Hi, just a quick question for Ugo, and this isn't being academic or philosophical, but on one hand you say, within institutions, however good a person you are, you act along with institutional culture. You can't be a great socialist in the World Bank. But on the other hand, you say the way to do the change is to use the institutional framework and set up a foundation for, say, for example, Teatro Valle, using the private property idea. Isn't that within an opposition? Or do tell us how to kind of avoid the trap of turning the Teatro Valle into a cultural industry corporation. Thanks.
Okay, let's take that.
All right, I will be academic and philosophical, actually. This is also for Hugo. Thank you for this invigorating primer on early modern political theory. It's always good to hear that. You maintained at some point that both the institutions of private property and the institution of the state were antagonistic to the commons. That is to say, both Locke and Hobbes are antagonistic to the commons. And certainly, I think historically, there's good reason for believing that, as Polanyi has demonstrated. But theoretically, at least, it seems to me, leftist political philosophy since Marx and Engels has relied on the possibility that the state might be the handmaiden and steward of the commons rather than antagonistic to it. So my question then is whether you can envision a future in which the state indeed is a steward of the commons rather than antagonistic to it, as it seems to be in the liberal bourgeois constitution, and whether in fact Podemos and Syriza are representing that possibility in the current moment.
Okay, thank you. Let's take one more here in the fourth row.
Good evening, I'm coming from the village, so I will not be very academic. I have two questions, one for the gentleman from Spain. I really don't understand why you think there should be some kind of conflict between grassroots movement and political option. I'm coming from the grassroots movement, but I'm also local councillor for more than 10 years. And frankly say, what we saw all the time in Croatia is when you have grassroots movement and they have political wings, and when political option understand that they are just political wing of the grassroots movement, there is no problem. But where you have politicians coming from big cities every 4 years for the election and say, okay, we are your political option, you are flesh and blood, you're going to vote for us, then there is a problem. Just for information, I'm coming from the biggest Croatian island. We got, we made project to be 2025 first CO2 neutral and energy 100% renewable island in the Mediterranean. We grow up our quantity of the top water from 2 to 6 million cubic meter because the climate change. And we saw first in Croatia waste management 2006, so we are really green as authority. But when we have problem that somebody think that he is politician given to us by God, and they want to help to us in green movement, in grassroots movement, to tell us what to do. So. And another question for gentlemen from Italy, I agree with you 110%, really. And my question is cooperatives. One day when you become authorities in the last election, and you want to really grow up top water on the island from 2 to 6 million square meters, or you want to invest 5 million euro in waste management, you need to have some kind of the tool. So if you have good utility company, as we have on my island, by the way, we got awards from Council of Europe 1999 as the best municipality on the Mediterranean for sustainability. Then you need cooperation on utility, on technical way, waste management, water, sewage system. Of course, we have energy cooperative to be renewable. We need to invest 90 million euro to have 70 megawatts of renewables. But on the end of the day, you need some kind of a technical cooperation on the local level. Via reconstruction our agriculture by the slow food cooperatives. But what to do when you become authority, when you have budget and you vote for budget in a city council?
Okay, thank you. So we have three for Ugo and one from Florent.
The tree boils down to really one, I guess, because and it's that I was, of course, confused and unclear. So I would like to try to restate what I was trying to say. What I'm saying is that we operate within constraints of institutions, okay, of established institutions. But on the other hand, okay, we institutions can constrain us in different ways. So institutions have a DNA, okay? So the institutions of modernity, private property and representative government, right now, to me, have extractive DNAs. So their function is to extract from the commons and to transform into capital. And therefore, when we operate within that constraint, we behave as extractive figures. So what we need to do is to change the DNA of our collective institutional organizations, introducing something that can be called a generative DNA, something that that gives us incentives to operate not so much in the interest of here and now, but to internalize the needs of those that are very far away or those that are not born yet, okay? To do that, we have to institutionalize the commons. Once we institutionalize the commons, how do you do that? For example, you know, you create a foundation that is obliged to think in the 30, 40, 50 years terms, that has long-term plans investment, that have governance structure that are based on turnation and not based on maintaining long-term the same role. You have collective leadership. You can, you know, create things in such a way that you produce all sorts of checks and balances, okay? Once you do that, then you need some other way to check that the generative purpose that you have created for your new institution is actually carried on. And there is where you need to figure out ways to actually measure the interest of future generation, the interest of survival, the interest of ecology in such a way that doesn't become, you know, completely arbitrary, but allows us some sort of understanding whether we're going in the right direction or not. So I don't see really a contradiction between saying that we operate within institutions and that we have to build institutions in a different way. Now, why is that private property? And they said that in a very provocative way, but it's something that answers also to the second question, the one of whether the public can be steward of the commons. The understanding on the left, and that was also my understanding until 2013, was that once you take a resource or something and you recognize it as a common, okay, and you, what you should do is actually to transform it, to transfer it to the public. So when we did the water referendum, it was against the privatization of water, and we thought, okay, we give it back to the municipalities, it's fine. As long as the municipalities are using it, they are the public, they will steward the resource in the interest of everybody. This is actually not true, because the structure of the corporation that runs water, as long as it remains within the way in which the institutions work, and this goes to your question, okay, those kind of organizations will have an incentive to sell as much water as possible, okay? So then you will say, well, you know, we are working well because we sold a lot of water, but the revenue from the water we are using for the kindergarten, for the street, or for whatever in the public interest, I don't give a damn. I don't care. I don't want that revenues for water are used for anything else than considering the water as a common. That means that you need to consume as little as possible because we are consuming already much more than our fair share of water in this part of the world, and we are leaving a lot of people far away thirsty because of our excessive consumption of water. You see? So the public and the private, they are both equal from the point of view of being extractive and on working on selling as much as possible of the water as a commodity. Creating an institution of the commons means to create a structure that actually makes incentives to those that operate within its boards, okay, to actually have incentives to reduce the amount of water you sell, not to sell as much as possible. Okay? And this is really kind of something that you cannot do if you have a major of the city that owns the water that needs your millions that you made from the water to pay for his next campaign by actually giving, you know, some good pavimentation to the streets, of giving some kindergarten to the kids of a certain quarter where he wants to be elected. Okay? So you need to emancipate the institutions of the commons from the control of either the profit motive or the concentrated power motive. So to do that, you need to, and you want to institutionalize that, the only way that I can imagine now is by using a subversive use of private law. Okay? So if you can create an institutional setting that is generative rather than extractive, that factors in the long term and the ecological and social use rather than the short term and the profit motive, and then you make it a property structure, then when the next, and you can actually be strong enough to have that happen, which I was not in Naples, but, you know, someone might be able to do so somewhere else, then, you know, what can happen is that the next time in which your government is not the steward of the commons anymore, is not even campaigning against for the commons anymore, is actually on the right wing and it's neoliberal in a proud way, and so decides that actually water should be on the market because you need to make profits on water and it's going to be more efficient to run it as a corporation for profit and blah, 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 and it's all crap that we hear all the time. The next time will happen that he will have to actually take away the property of the new entity, and he will be stuck with the institutions of the European Court of Human Rights that will say, oh, that's private property. You cannot take it away unless there is a public interest and unless you pay a compensation and unless there is a law that allows you to do that. Because if it's not private property and it remains within the domain of the possibilities of the government to act, there is not even the need to show that there is any public necessity in order to privatize it and to go the other way around. So what I'm trying to do is to make some of the institutions that are out there that we inherited from modernity to work in a counter-hegemonic way. So we talked about hegemony. I think we should talk also about counter-hegemony if we want to get the full picture. Hope it was okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Florent?
Yeah, I got the question about the grassroots against OVS, political party. I don't want you and me to misunderstand each other, because I'm from the grassroots movement. I come from the degrowth movement and all the guys going occupy fields to make some collective urban garden, for example, make some local currency. But at the same time, I will be member of the European Parliament next year. So I am on both sides. So I agree with you on that side. But I think that we have to know why we are, for example, you are a local councillor, why I will be a member of European Parliament. I don't think that will change a lot of things in European Parliament. That's not my expectation of that. But maybe to say that, I think that we have to be in the institution because they exist. That's my first point. They exist, so we have to be there, because if we are not there, the right wing will be there, or the growth people, extractivist people will be there. So we have to have a voice there, because they have a weight on that. That's the first point. Then I think that we are not, you said something like authority. I don't consider myself as authority. I consider myself as I have to cooperate with other people. And I think that the role of the state, of European Parliament, of the council, local council, is to cooperate with grassroots movement, try to put forward what they did and what they did well. I think that's our new role, coordination, cooperation, on that kind of way. And then maybe the last point, because I'm quite pessimistic about the future of humanity, I have to admit that, because when you look at the reality in front and you say that we are going directly to ecological collapse, we don't have so much time. So why am I in the European Parliament? Because I think we have to have some people with affinity there when the collapse will be there. Maybe that's another point, maybe I won't say that in TV because that's something a bit more difficult to say, but ecological collapse has to be part of a strategy because it's already there. Because I don't think we have so much time to revert what's going on right now. We don't have so much time. The club of Roma said that 2030 will be the collapse of population, and I think we are going directly on that way because that's a very inert body where you have to change, and I don't see a majority on our side to say that growth is not possible, that we can have this kind of ecological, industrial world. So that's why I think we have to be on every side to change the world. We have to change the cultural one, we have to change the structural one, you have to be on the political one too. But taking into account that the world of tomorrow is quite bad, and so we have to make a lot of cooperation to be quite strong when the bad moment will be there.
Thank you. Since we still have some time left, I would like to pass the microphone on the right side. We had three questions there, if I'm not wrong. Yeah.
Thank you. I have a question for Professor Mattei. Actually, requires a short introduction, but so to follow up on your idea on the need for institution building in order to protect the commons, the way I see it, if you look at the TTIP, and the vision of the world that it has to offer, I think that the truth of the matter is that there is an exactly the same parallel process going on the other side, in which actually corporations are doing pretty much the same thing. They're building a parallel system covering all three levels of power. They have the ISD, just if you look at through the TTIP, you have the regulatory cooperation as actually giving them almost de facto legislative initiative. You have the ISDS clauses which allow them to build their own court system, and actually by the very fact that they have the executive institutions, our executive institutions which are promoting the agenda, they pretty much co-opted them. So in that setting, I mean, it really, for me, it was pretty much a process of falling through the rabbit hole. And then you realize that you really live in a, when you open up your eyes to the world in which we actually live in corporate feudalism in a way, or we are preparing to live in one. And in that sense, the Game of Thrones is very logical why people love it, because at least on the subconscious level, we really can relate to it. And my question for you is really, in a world in which if I come back to the idea of Professor Piketty and the capital in the 21st century, if you have the system in which more property is inherited than is earned, and you have some very rich people who are in that actually way trying to protect their children from competition, then, I mean, and on the other hand, you have the disempowerment of people, and we actually bought the idea that we can have a democracy without educating citizens to become citizens, and that's okay. I mean, in Croatia, last year, we had a process of civic education completely blocked, completely stopped, and it's like it never happened. And we all accepted it completely, like that it's okay to have democracy without educating citizens to become citizens. And that's something which I really, like, my question for you is, do you think that it's time to, I don't know, for a declaration of independence of the 21st century? I don't know. Because I don't see this process of institution building that you are mentioning, I don't see it happening in this state of play.
Okay, we take another one.
Hello, mine is a little bit more optimistic. I also have a question for Professor Mattei. If you can just shortly, and also for Ska and for all of you, if you can just shortly comment on what is the political potential and the reality of the next step of the struggle for water that happened in Italy and that has now moved to the European level through the Right to Water campaign, which has proved to be done in Laclau's manner, but also in Gramsci's manner, and where a very strong message and very strong value has really been placed on a policy-making agenda of the EU and has really provoked the change and has actually, maybe has not provoked the change, but has challenged the institutions to tackle the very concept of whether water is a commodity or whether it is a common good and a right, you know, basic right, and something that every human being and every animal can relate to, because we cannot live without water. So it seems to me that strategically and tactically it has been extremely important and smart to pursue this struggle and move it to the level of the European struggle. And I wonder what you see are the prospects, and whether we should really focus on not many struggles, but few of them, with strong symbolic and real potential to change at all levels the way we interact and the way we create our political community and our institutions. I'm a little bit afraid of, not a little bit, I'm afraid of the dispersion, because our capacities are really limited. And we in Croatia have the same people working on 10 parallel struggles, and they're all interconnected, but we get really exhausted, you know. So if you can comment a little bit.
Thank you. And the third one up.
Good evening. I was just wondering, when we speak about democracy here and how we should have more democracy, of which type of democracy are we speaking of? Not in a philosophical way or anything like that, but it seems to me that Ms. Keller is speaking about majority of democracy when she says, well, most of the EU is conservative, so what should we do? Maybe try to get another more progressive majority and so on. So to me, this struggle seems to be going then very slow, because I truly believe, and I'm not an anti-democrat, that democracy is a mechanism that is too slow for us to introduce these type of changes. It is almost like the old French philosophy when they say we have to force the people to be free currently, because we are in a very dramatic situation regarding these changes. So is Mr. Mattei, because he sounds more optimistic to me here, actually speaking about self-management, which is something we had but never had it in practice in full, but actually this struggle has to also be an anti-capitalistic struggle. So in a way, are we talking about self-management? This is my question. And if we do, how do we put it in the European agenda?
Thank you. I would like to also invite all speakers to involve these questions into closing words, because we will wrap it up. Just take the notion that this is the final round, and to include also answers in your closing words. So I think that we can go by order, Ugo, Ska, and Florent. Ugo.
Thank you. Well, you see, these are all extremely important questions, and I think this. I do not believe too much in single issue politics, and I think that the water campaign was important. It is and was a great victory in Italy, but the problem was that it was not translated into a broader vision. And I'm not saying it was not translated into electing a few members of parliament. Don't misread me. I don't care about that. We actually elected 50 good members of parliament last time, because my friend Nikki Vendola was very smart and playing with the game. And the left in Italy, my side, the real left, not the pretended one, is overrepresented in parliament, okay, at the moment. Is overrepresented. It has like about 50 people in the Italian parliament, but there is no difference whatsoever between this time that is overrepresented and the last time that was not represented at all. It doesn't matter, okay? That means just that there are 50 more people that are in parliament that could do things, that actually do try to do things. I'm not saying they are doing nothing, but there is no way to see that what they are doing has any impact whatsoever in the political conversation. So when I say that it was not translated into politics, I'm not saying it was not translated into the parliamentary seats. It was not translated into diffused consciousness of the situation in which we are, of a citizenship that stops being just consumers and become persons, you know, these kind of things was not done. And the result is that today, water privatization is rampant. You know, is not nothing really is doing as well as the privatization of water in Italy and in Europe. But you know, if you can just see it with the mineral water, it's completely normal to go to the restaurant, ask for tap water, and having people say, "No, I cannot give you that." You say inventing some regulations. You know, the Chamber of Commerce persuades the barkeepers in Italy that they are not allowed to give the tap water, you know, things like that, and people drink the bottles of bottled water all the time, and the business of bottled water is huge, and these companies receive for nothing the concession to take away the water from the our Alps and bottle them. For nothing, and there is an authority that has the power to decide that, and guess who is sitting in that authority? Elected politicians that are the same that go around and saying that are for water as a universal right, and then give away for nothing the concession to tap the water to the corporations that then pay them, you know, spaces in the newspaper and things like that. So the system is completely corrupted around water. So I don't think, I mean, of course it has been a good thing to bring it at the European level. Of course, it is important that people begin to wake up on the idea that it's not a matter of nature, and of course that you open the tap and the water comes down. I would like people to know more about how the water actually then works, which is a complex system. It's a huge gift that we received from the past generation, and we are just not returning to the future one because we're not investing at all in making infrastructures or water any decent these days. So it's a very complex system. I think that we have to translate it in politics, and in translating it in politics means developing different languages, developing different ways to talk to the people, and understanding that the revolution will not happen with just one line. You know, she might be right that the European Parliament might one day change the world. I might be right in saying that won't happen. Doesn't really matter. I think what matters is that we consider the society as a gigantic bunch of wet wood that we want to set in fire. And it's very, very difficult to set it in fire, okay? But if we try to set it in fire from just one side, you are certain it will not happen, okay? If we try from many different sides, you know, at some point someone gets lucky and maybe the whole thing that potentially will burn actually will eventually burn, okay? So I think that would be the metaphor of the kind of thing we should do. I'm a big fan and a big, I actually studied quite a bit of the Yugoslavian legal system about co-worker participation and all of that in the past. Of course, should be upgraded. Of course, I would not like to come to Croatia now to say, well, you know, that system was much better as it was. It probably was much better from many perspectives in how it ran in running the corporation and the companies, you know, could have been done better. But the principle that workers actually are not inputs of the productive process, are not commodities. Because today in Europe, workers are commodities. We are all commodities, you know? We work for the system as consumers, we work for the system as workers. Flexibility just means that we're not entitled to a life, that there is a property structure on our life, because if you have to work for 9-10 hours a day in a company, and all your work, all the surplus of your work is made by the top of the corporation, you are basically a slave. People know at what time they're gonna work the day after, the day before. Contracts are so short, you know, there are certain working conditions today that are appalling, right in the heart of Europe. So these all things, you know, are part of the necessity to think from the commons perspective, to think critically, to see how you could organize things differently. But you have really to make a somersault in the way of thinking, a complete shift. And I'm closing on this. You know, for example, today it is completely taken for granted that it is normal and actually fair that you want to access to higher education, you're supposed to pay. So students that want to pursue higher education, a master or a PhD, are supposed to pay. Professors are paid out of the money of the students. Okay? So the relationship between one generation and the other is that the generation of the kids is paying the generation of the father to teach them something. We need to reverse that. People should be paid to study. Because those that study today as kids are actually those, if we reason in a commons perspective, are actually those that will allow us to maintain and serve and keep our society in the future. Only if we see everybody as an individual against everybody else, we can consider it fair to make people pay in order to take a master or a PhD. But if we get out of that vision, which is the competitive vision of reality of one against the other, then it becomes completely clear that those that study are actually putting their effort in the interest of everybody, not only in the interest of themselves. You see, all of these are transformations that the commons movement is ripe to produce in the deep understanding of society and of politics. There is a need to work hard, still to study and still to make practices, but there is also a need to, you know, recognize each other and to, you know, be capable of learning from all the experiences that are around the world in the past as well as in the present that work in the direction of allowing us to transmit something to the future generation.
Thanks for the questions. I think the Right to Water initiative was really instrumental, was really, really crucial. One, on the content, of course, but on the other hand, also because it really shifted power in the commission, at least. They were finally getting aware that they can't do that, and that does not mean they're not going to try again, but it really shifted something in, you know, who's going to make decisions here and who's going to be listened to. So I think that was really, really instrumental. And of course, I very much agree that it's very difficult to focus on single issues. But on the other hand, I completely understand the constraints that you face as organizations, like simply not having huge amounts of women power around and not having huge amounts of time at your hand. So I think one can focus on a couple of issues that are symbols of something more. Like, we don't have to make one campaign on TTIP, and one on CETA, and one on TISA, and I don't know, one on Singapore, and I don't know what. You can make one on TTIP and then grow from that. But you have to make, you just have to make sure that people understand it's not, you know, just one thing, and if we kill that, then we're all saved. But it's actually also a symptom of a broader trade policy that is hampering all of us. Or I think another crucial thing is Paris, is the climate event this November, December. Of course, it's a symptom of the climate policy that's happening, or rather not happening, around the globe. But it can be a very, very important focal point. For that, I would really see that. And also, I think very importantly, is to not just tackle those big global things like climate or whatever, but also really to look at the local level and how that influences, how those global issues influence the local issues, but also look at the local issues that are symptoms of something greater. Because very often with those rather small, local, small in the sense of not touching the whole world right now, you can reach more people, you can reach out to different people, but also you can spread the word, the work on more shoulders and make for all of us more sustainable. And there also come to the issue of the majority and is democracy too slow. Well, I think in the end, we're doing what we're doing because we want to create indeed a better world for the people that live in it. And that's what democracy is all about. So I think it's absolutely vital and non-negotiable to go out and convince people, because that's all what it's all about. You cannot, you know, liberate other people if they don't want to be liberated. You have to have people, at least you have to have people on your side, as many as you can get. And it does not have to be a 60% majority, no. You can do something with strong minority voices, absolutely. But we know without doing things for people, without asking the people, I think does not work. And that's why we need to get out of closed rooms, out of meeting rooms, and try to convince people of what we're actually standing for. And one more thing about the majority. Indeed, it's very difficult to do politics also in the European Parliament against the majority. But first of all, we can change the majorities. And I think it's really worrying that more and more people from the left camp, let's say, for example, don't bother to go to vote anymore. Because you might think, oh, well, maybe it's not useful or it does not change the majorities. But actually, it does change majorities. It has a huge influence. In Germany, we have this huge contradiction of actually having a majority of people who are voting or who are left in the topics that they're thinking about. But in the end, we always get a conservative majority in the parliament. How does this go together? And can we not change that? Why aren't people voting in the sense that they actually say on polls what the issue is going for? So I think that is super instrumental. But also, if we don't have the majority, we can do something also in the institutional parliamentary sphere. I have no idea about the Italian political system, and it's not much. But in the European Parliament, we constantly have votes where the majority is decided by one or two votes. So if we would have one or two more Grillini, Podemos, Greens from I don't know where sitting in that house, we would win, for example, next week's votes on the conflict minerals. That's going to be one of those votes that is super, super crucial. It actually really influences people's lives on conflict minerals, on making sure that what we produce in the European Union does not include minerals that are feeding and financing conflicts around the world. It's really instrumental, it's really crucial. And it's going to be decided by a slight majority. We have no idea how it's going to end. And really, there it makes such a difference to have one or two more people. So I think it's really, really worth fighting for at all different levels in the institutions, because we have to use them because they're there, and we can use them. We have to use them for the full. That does not mean that, you know, we only go for one way. It does not mean that, you know, you do your vote and then that's it for the rest of the life. But it does not mean either that we do only outside struggle and forget what's happening inside the institutions.
Okay.
Yeah, that's my
word. We have a final word.
Oh, yeah, the final words. So, and that's true when you say that we are so few people in so much struggles, and the same ones. And that's the case, in your case in Croatia, and the case in Spain, for example. So that's true, and I believe, as you, that we have to focus on a few struggles, symbolical struggles, to be very clear on that. I think that's very, very important. I think Scar said it before, TTIP is one of this one, because TTIP is the prototype of what we don't want, or the bad way that we don't want to go. That's a democratic threat, that's an ecological threat, social threat, threat to animals, threat to everything. We have to go on the other side. So I think TTIP has to be in the center of our struggles this year and next years. Then, speaking about rights to water, I don't know if you know, but there will be a march to Brussels in August or September, organized by the social movements on rights for water. And I think that could be another one, because they will try to link struggles and to link the struggle, for example, for water and TTIP. So I think that's a good one to intend to make a more European one, in the sense Scar said, and to have this global way and point of view. And I think that climate change is definitely a good one too, because we have the Paris moment, we have COP21 in December in Paris, and as Naomi Klein said recently, because she wrote this book on climate change and capitalism, she said something that I think is crucial. She said that the new narrative against capitalism could be climate change. So I think that can be the narrative that you can use to have more struggles together between different social movements, speaking about justice, sustainability, and democracy. And then when you speak about self-management, I think that self-management is a key point. That's true for me. That's a key point, self-management, because we have to just have the power in our hands and just use it. And we can make a lot of things right now with self-management, like urban garden, like local currencies, like energy cooperative, producers and consumers cooperatives. That's the case. But we don't have to forget at the same time that self-management needs to be in contact with institutions at the same time. So we need to understand how we can manage to have self-management and institutions at the same time. Local institutions, regional institutions, state institutions, and European institutions. So self-management, that's not an island outside of the world. That's an island inside the world. We have to connect these islands together of self-management and to connect them with the institutions, because we can't have institutions against self-management. We have to have institutions with self-management. That's very, very different. And to finish with the closing words, when you talk once more about Game of Thrones, I think that we can't make politics with Game of Thrones. I know that people understand Game of Thrones, but we have to change once more the narrative. Because if we say to people the narrative is Game of Thrones, well, we'll act as Game of Thrones. So we won't change the world and we want to change that. Because I think more about, for example, about Gandhi. Gandhi said, you have to be the world that you want to see. And I think that's the point. We have to be the world that we want to see in self-management, in grassroots movement, and in politics. We have to do what we want to be in the world.
Thank you. I think that we didn't fail when we decided that it will be the topic of the last session. I would like to thank Hugo, to thank Sky, and to thank Florent that they have been running the last mile of Subversive together with us in these late hours. And I would just like to say that the Subversive Festival or Subversive Marathon continues. Until next year. Thank you.